see everyone here this evening, especially how I'm going to start off this morning. But this is a really important topic, and so again, I'm really excited to see everyone here. My name is Brian Armstead. I'm the Director of Policy and Partnerships for the Philadelphia Education Fund. We, again, are very excited about working with the members of the Teachers of the Utility and holding this dialogue and this discussion. As you all know, there are a lot of things happening in the school district, a lot of moving parts, but really there's nothing that's more central and more important than helping to create the most effective teaching and learning that can possibly happen for our kids here in Philadelphia. I'm going to introduce in a second our moderator, Kate Shaw, who's the Executive Director of Research for Action. But one thing that I will say is sort of as framing for this, is as we start to talk about a lot of the ideas that people have put on the table, what we're expecting, just generally speaking, is that there are some things that people will agree on, that's the main plan. There'll be other things that people will agree on with some caveats, and there'll be other things that people just fundamentally don't agree on. And you know what? That's okay. Because one of the things the Philadelphia Education Fund that we firmly believe in is the importance of dialogue. And I'll say, as a friend of mine says frequently, if two people agree completely on everything, then one of them is not necessary. And so, again, and so with that in mind, again, I want to thank you. And I will say this as a quick plug. Just as a reminder to everybody, you know, as soon as you get home, and then tomorrow, and then the day after, get all your friends to call your city council people and your state representative and tell them to find them. So, take y'all.
years working for the Philly Public Schools, 5 years as the State Home and Green Secondary Education Commissioner, and now 2 years at United Way helping bring their education to
I'm Shanee Garner. I work for Public Citizens for Children and Youth, and since we have a board member, I'll just talk a little bit about our educational work. So PCCY is a new organization, and I lead the education work. That work runs the gamut. Right now, about 90% of my time is devoted to funding at the city and state level. So that's what we're working on primarily. But recently, we signed on to this coalition. And then about 2 months ago, we also published our full audit that did an inventory on barriers to admissions, and then populations that may or may not have been underrepresented in charter schools, with recommendations for how to strengthen that. So our work runs the gamut. I'd say it's primarily centered around access, equity, and accountability.
My name is Leslie Weiner, and I am on the board of PCCY. But more importantly, I think today I'm here as the daughter of a former I have people in my daughter who started in the public schools in 01 through the state over the school. So
I'm Darren Snowden. I'm CEO of the Philadelphia Education Fund. Born and raised in Philadelphia, pretty well community consciousness. The challenges of children in the city were mine recently about. I was out of the area for some time in graduate school. I worked in very low-income middle schools in Springfield, Massachusetts, in transitional housing shelters. Back to Philly, I worked in design and built a school and treatment center for Jewish kids from the boroughs in Eastern North Philadelphia. Designed global substance use outreach, designed and delivered by teenagers and teenagers, and ran a teacher training organization that also attends academic enrichment and support. Every decision I've made in my career has been centrally focused on what I can do best for young people. And I'm extremely proud to now get ahead of one of those great teams and what we can do in the city of Philadelphia to support teachers and students.
Thanks, everybody. I think the fact that we've got such a great turnout in the face of, I don't know what this storm is going to be, if it's coming at all, I think it's really clear that people are incredibly concerned about what's happening in the school district. Philadelphia, of course, for good reason. We know all too well the budget deficit that the district is facing and the struggles that many people in this room have been engaged in trying to raise the kind of money that we need to run an effective school system. And yet we know that we're facing down a budget situation that may not end in plugging the hole that is there. There's lots of different components of that, but of course, in the middle of all of that is teachers. And so it's clear that we've got people up here on this panel, some of whom represent teachers in Philly, other folks who represent Coalition for Effective Teaching. And I think that everybody has descriptions of the two groups and their positions and platforms. Rather than get into begin with a detailed discussion or debate about the different elements of the platform, I think it might be better and more constructive if we begin the discussion with a question that I'd like to pose to the panel, which is this. In both of the organizations speak about the conditions and resources necessary to ensure that we have effective teachers. And yet, because of the budget deficit, it seems to be at least in question whether or not we will have those resources available to ensure that teachers receive the support that they need. I don't think there's anybody in the city that doesn't want to ensure that we've got effective teachers, but of course, the devil is in the detail. So the question I would like to pose to the panel is, given what the reality is, given that it is unlikely that we're going to be awash in money anytime soon, what are the conditions that you think should exist to ensure effective teachers? And in the face of the likelihood that we won't have enough resources to ensure that teachers get the support they need, what should we be doing now and in the fiscal year or the school year ahead as we think about how to respond to Act 82 that's coming down the pipe that is requires the district to put into place a teacher effectiveness set of metrics? So who would like to start? Diane. Oh, Kathleen.
yeah, I'd be happy to start. This is something that I spent a ton of time thinking about. I think there were sort of two parts to the question. what can we, do to improve conditions for teachers and students given the budgetary issues that we're facing? And the other is about acting to what we can do. So I think even within the budgetary issues that we're facing, we can do a lot to improve professional community and culture among the teachers in Philadelphia, which is something that in our work, the teachers in Philly's work, the teachers, we found something that the teachers really are craving. They want to be connected, they want to be collaborating with their colleagues, and that in most cases, teachers feel fairly isolated. And so I think what we can do is trust teachers, give teachers the opportunity and the flexibility to build that culture and that community among themselves. And what we've seen is that by building connections and a cultural capital, we can make incredible gains in the kind of culture, professional culture that we have at schools, which always means gains for just learning of the learning community in general at schools. So I think we need teachers more time to collaborate. I think we need to support teacher networks, like the Philadelphia Writing Project, or Teachers in Philly, or Teacher Action Group, because teachers learn best from other teachers. And we have so many incredible resources in the school district of Philadelphia that often go neglected, and those are our teachers, because so many of them are really at what they do and just need the opportunity to share with one another. So I think that that's one thing that we could really focus on that would not be a high cost kind of measure. And then in terms of Act 82, I think that we're looking at something that is based on, well, you know, 50% of teachers' evaluations will be based on data, a lot of it's standardized. So there are a lot of things that we can do to make this a richer, more meaningful set of, you know, way to evaluate teachers and give teachers feedback. And those recommendations are sort of outlined in our position statement. We're looking at using portfolios and projects. We're looking at reframing this idea that we can evaluate teachers based on sort of building measures like attendance and promotion and graduation rate. Mm-hmm. As teachers, we know there are a lot of problems with those kinds of metrics. A lot of unintended consequences. So again, we feel like we need to go to teachers to find out what's going to be the best way to improve teacher quality. And the best way to hold people accountable is, at least in my situation, I feel like I'm most accountable to the people in my building, right? To the teachers. And I also know that good teaching looks really, really different at my school and at Sam's school or other schools. And so these measures for evaluation need to be locally developed within a school setting, a particular school setting, so that they're actually meaningful for that community.
Anybody else? I'm jumping in the first half of the softball. I think that this is, by the way, not a coalition platform. I mean, the FBI is completely committed and supportive of teacher collaboration, and we think that networks are really important to the future of the city, and we're really glad that Teachers in Philly exists and that TAG exists with the writing project and so forth. So we think that is not just that's a great way to both improve practice and to improve voices in the policy conversation in the city. So thank you guys for existing. And it's important. It's important. Act 82 is interesting. The teacher evaluation stuff is really interesting. We share a concern. We had fun about the percentage of evaluation based on building level data. Pittsburgh shared that concern, actually reduced to 5%. The NCTQ report that came out shared that concern, recommended reducing it as well. And I think it was a simple question of, well, if you're trying to determine the performance of an individual person and you look at the types of stuff that the building level data is assessing, could you actually get at what that person was doing by looking at that? I come out of the background having had a lot of nonprofit management leadership training, where the notion of 360 evaluation is really valued. And I guess that means the kind of people that you interact with. And so I think that the notion of student surveys is a great thing to add into the mix. Why? Because they collect a huge amount of information and sit there hour after hour, day after day, observing. serving teachers, and if constructed properly, you can get a lot of rich information. I think we're very legitimate concerned when people start down this path. Oh, what if I'm just hard on a kid? Are they going to evaluate me poorly? And find something that, in fact, that when these things are put together, it's actually great information, rich information for kids, and sometimes you really can't trust kids and empower kids. Which would go back, which to me, when I think of accountability, yes, to the people in the building and to the teachers, but also, of course, to the children that you're teaching. I think those are as high level, as I don't think just a couple of things.
I really agree with the comments you made about teachers needing time to work together. I think that's a really important component. Close fellow members on the coalition for me, teaching is a team sport. And I think that's really important. In fact, I'm a big believer that there should be time lost into every single day. It should be part of teachers' paid time to meet together and talk together and interact with each other. I don't know how an individual teacher can ever hope to get through the day without being able to talk to colleagues. Those of us who don't work in classrooms, who work in the work environment, know that a good part of our day is spent talking to colleagues and learning some ideas and problem solving. And teachers need that same time and space. And frankly, when you're in front of a classroom with 30 kids in front of you, you don't have any downtime, and you don't have time to necessarily pop over to the classroom next door and talk to a teacher. So I would agree. I do think it's the way it's currently structured, it can be costly because you need prep teachers and you need to roster them, but I think that is well worth the time and effort, and that is a cost well worth investing in. The school has a help markers for that. Let me make a little bit of a case for some of the standardized measures in teacher evaluation. Let me tell you why, not necessarily teacher evaluation, but why standardized measures are important. I am old enough to remember when we actually didn't have I will tell you that looking at statewide data, every district had its own assessment, and it looked as if the kids in Bradley were achieving at the same level as the kids in Philadelphia, because everybody was doing really graduates in the local assessment. And we knew, though, that the kids who were graduating from Philadelphia were not getting great quality instruction. Now, is that the teacher's fault? Not necessarily not. But we had no good way to compare and ensure equity across the state, because we have no real good measure of what kids were learning that was at least somewhat comparable. You know, at the end of the day, algebra is algebra and algebra. And yes, kids come into a classroom with a different set of learning and backgrounds and expertise, but at the end of the day, we want every kid to meet the same standards, and so the standardized test scores are an important way to ensure equity. And sometimes we don't think of that, but I want to remember the times when we didn't even know if kids were getting as well as good of an education as they were in the Magna as they were in Philly, because we have no common measures across the system. That is one of the few cases for standardized assessments that we don't hear, but I want to make sure that we remember that that is the good case.
So, Diane, to take that notion, and do you think that the same notion applies to evaluating the effectiveness of teachers? So, Kathleen, you made the argument that effectiveness measures or assessments of teachers need to be locally developed because every school is different and good teaching looks different in different settings. Would people on the panel agree that all evaluations of teachers should be developed locally at the school level, or is there something to Diane's argument about having consistent metrics of teacher effectiveness, whatever they might be, that sort of extend not just across the district but across multiple districts?
I'd like to add on, like, the variables that we look at when we look at Brad University, when we look at our students that are teaching in the inner city, we're looking at socioeconomic issues, right? Mm-hmm. And so, how do we put that into the platform, right? So how do we look at social capital that the students that Bradford had versus the students that I had that we teach? And so if you're making that comparison, again, is it a fair comparison?
Well, the question is, do you make the comparison simply on outcomes, or do you make the comparison based on measures of growth? Right? And so I think, and I do not mean to say that we have the teacher evaluation system here that's all worked out. But I do think it is fair to say that is a kid getting 12 months of growth for 12 months of instruction? And I think it is very fair to say
then we can look at, coming back to the portfolio, right? Kathleen, we can look at growth in portfolios. So that's a tool that we can use.
And I mean, I can certainly echo what you said about the effect of standardized testing. And I think that, you know, even though I sort of oppose the widespread use of standardized testing, I see standardized testing, I can say that one good thing that's come out of it is that it's really revealed the vast inequity that we have in our system in America. I think that it's done a really nice job of painting that picture that we have, you know, two tiers, at least. But our best schools are just way, 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 way different from some of, you know, some of our schools where students are really getting the same education. But I do think that sort of the benefit is there. And I think that a lot of people who tout standardization think that, and I heard you use the phrase that they ensure equity. And while I think that they do, I've got a picture of inequity, I don't think that they can hold us to achieve equity.
They don't ensure equity, but they are a check on whether there is equity, and they are not the only check.
Yeah, and we also, I mean, I think that this, some of the testing that we do now, like the NAEP, which is sort of a, you know, sampling, can do that job effectively, and we don't need to test every single child two times a year for 6 days, 3 hours a year, that we can probably, you know, reveal or measure inequity in our system without putting every single child through that.
Anybody else from our panel want to weigh in on this particular issue? How we might capture effectiveness and whether there's room for some kind of assessment of effectiveness or whether it's just false precision, because that's certainly one of the teams.
I think actually regardless of if you're using test scores or portfolio, we want to have a really well-designed standardized method to do it. And in fact, the consortium that's working up in New York has what I thought was 30, but that was 28 schools doing this work. What they're using is rigorous and validated standard method of how they're testing across the company of schools, even though they're using what might be a more holistic approach. So I would say there is a lot of value in having your methods standard across a large percentage that you can do some comparisons and see what's happening in school to schools.
One thing I'd like to point out is that Savage Inequalities was published in 1991. So we really need the PSSA to understand that kids in Philadelphia are not getting the same education as wealthy places. And to the point about locally developed things, whether we're talking about Common Core, whether we're talking about whatever this month's thing that's going to work is, if it's never coming from a place of, you know, an actual child that you talk to, you probably have a decent sense of what they're doing and how you measure that. If I'm never in that conversation, then that tool is never going to be as good as it can be for me and kid that teacher partner. Does every teacher have the time and ability to do that? No. But we're precluded from those kind of efforts, and I'm always going to fail.
So this leads to the next natural question in my mind, which is, if there's a system of evaluation that is a little bit more finely brought than the current system of evaluation, which tends to assess 98% of teachers as satisfactory. What happens to, what do we do with this information, whatever it is? What do we do with information that shows us that there are teachers that are not doing what we want them to do, what they're not being effective in the classroom, they're not sort of helping students to learn at a level that we really think they need. What's your sort of opinion about how you use that information, how much information needs to be there before an action is taken, and what action steps should be taken?
Very generally speaking, we need to move away from ranking and toward rating and away from sorting towards support. Thank you. And by support, I mean it's really easy to figure out what teachers are not doing. Job they can do. they need tools, they need resources, they need networks. And then that happens first before we start the conversation about when we get about that, when we get about next month, when we get about next year. If you're not willing to be the line supervisor of the future and do the support and tools and resources, then you're going to want to
be. I would think that in addition to the tools and resources, they need that. I hope that includes coaching.
Absolutely.
And professional development. I mean, it's like, in any kind of industry, you get regular evaluations on how you're doing the job, and if those evaluations are not up to par or standard, then there are mechanisms that are put in place to help move that person along, and then there are regular check-ins to help make sure that the person's there. If they continue to not make the improvement, then you've got to address something, but you need to have, whether that's with the principal, or whoever, some kind of mechanisms that are in place that allow them to do coaching to help teachers improve.
Yeah, I think I'm going to kind of agree with you definitely, but also agree with the chair and say that there should be systems in place to support teachers who are struggling. But also that I find this topic dominates far too many conversations about how to fix our schools.
Losing their system principals and losing their secretaries, They're not going to have the resources. Like, when are they going to have time to come into my classroom? So, I feel sorry for any principal, but it's going to be really, really difficult to do this type of evaluation. And even prior to these lack of resources, if a principal is stuck with a teacher that's not effective, there's systems in place to get rid of an effective teacher. And so that's just a matter of due process, the protocol, support, and if we have a bad teacher, then okay, where do you go? You know, the system's in place for that.
A couple of things. I agree with Diane. To me, the key in the teacher evaluation system is that it provides nuanced information that helps teachers understand where their challenges are and where their strengths are, and give you a roadmap to improvement. And it also provides information that in fact differentiates between teachers that are doing real well, teachers that aren't. And if it doesn't provide that type of information, it's not really an evaluation system. And I think where some of this angst about it started is because right now, 99.whatever% error rate, it's binary, it's yes, no. And then B, 99%+ rate of effective, and then 0.whatever% or not. So all of a sudden people think, well, wait a minute, that can't be true. So we've gotten real worried about, well, we're not differentiating. And then, and so people start to work on it, and it becomes a backup. And also, and I've heard you say there's a process in place to remove the, you know, challenge or low performance users. You're right, there is. Talking to principals, it sounds like it, at the end of the day, takes a lot more of their energy if they wanted to accomplish it. And so I would, my key, let me just say, I just want to point out that. I'm just trying to point out that. Where the kind of say so hold on, we're starting to respect the work. And I think back to my wife worked in part of the service for 10 years. And the people in the part of the service didn't have work anyone. They work day in and day out. PhD was the most community, the worst of humanity, and to what we had to have in our children. And those people were incredible. There were people in that same job. Came in, never turned on their computer, went out to lunch, and there was no way, there was no evaluation system to differentiate, and you as a supervisor have to dedicate a year to rewarding one person and removing all the other person. Which is just to say, people just want to know. If we know that can happen, then we should focus our time. We need to focus our time on lauding those who are doing great and supporting and growing everyone else, and then what? And then just, it's on that far end. Okay, then let's not have the lowest performers over time to go through. And as someone that's been in leadership now for a while, the worst part of my job, hands down, the worst part of my job is if I have to get rid of that person. No matter how they're performing, even if I don't like the person, what are you going to do with it? First, you name. And they have rent or mortgage, kids or something, you don't have to do it. It's a, I believe, although I, that most leaders feel the same way.
So I think I feel like we're falling back into that effective versus ineffective argument. When a lot of, at least the coalition's platform, is also about principles, and it's about what management changes the district could actually make. So I think that one of the things that could stop us from falling into this like proverbial hole is to really think about what is the district doing to support teachers and principals on a climate level. I have graduated from Philly Public Schools, and I've taught in Philly Public Schools, and I've never attended one, whether that was a Masterman or West Philly High, that had a comprehensive school-wide behavior plan. You know, I had never walked into a school and knew what curriculum I was using. There was a textbook, and there was some shiny book with a lot of boxes and graphic organizers in it, but there was no comprehensive plan. So the way I taught my kids thesis statements was very different than the way anyone had ever taught it before. So there's that constant churn and that lack of continuity, I think, in terms of climate, that makes it really hard for kids to learn in, and it makes it really hard for parents, for principals to function in, right? Because, like, it's just this weird, like, hurting instead of this really concerted effort where there can be collaboration. So I think one of the things to look at in terms of the coalition is also, how do we make sure there are prevention-based plans in place, right? We know what the data says about restorative practices, and we know what the data says about positive behavior supports. So what are we doing to hold the district accountable to make sure that they're investing in those things that make life easier and safer and better for everyone? I mean, I never felt like let's realize that everyone has some other responsibility here, but let's make sure that we're holding every single level accountable. And I think so much of the conversation is filled with this teacher point of view that we get away from the other things that we're also talking about too. It's like, how do we know that a principal is doing the right job or doing a good job in supporting their teachers? And how do we also know that the district is supporting everyone who works for them? And I think that there's a lot of work to be done on both fronts.
Okay, so I have gotten several questions, but at least half of them are, why don't you just open it up to the audience? So I'm going to honor that request. And I'm going to put a few guidelines in place. We've gotten into this before. Please don't use your time cut falling with your grandstand. If you have a question, ask the question. But let's make sure that we don't sort of have one person dominating the conversation. Okay? All right. Let's start with you.
Thank you.
And can you please tell us who you are?
Okay, I'm Elliot Seif. I'm a longtime educator and part of the consultant, and I volunteer my time in schools quite a bit. So I have a number of questions, but the one I'm going to phrase is this discussion of these discussions seem to reinvent the wheel. And there are districts across the country that have put into place some very successful, very excellent teacher evaluation, teacher effectiveness, teacher growth systems. But what I know about is Montgomery County, Maryland. It's known throughout the country, but there are many others, one of which is that performance assessment consortium model, a very different kind of model. So why don't we just start to look at those and say, here's some models to start with and work from them, rather than seemingly a discussion I heard 20 years ago reinventing that discussion, when we know that there are already models in place that we should be incorporating.
So before the panelists answer, I will point out that there is Act 82. So part of the answer to that question is that we have Act 82 in place now that has provides some flexibility, but in other ways is not particularly flexible about how we would assess teachers. And so with that in mind, I'll hand this to the panel.
Yeah, I mean, I would echo that and say, yeah, we have this law now that passed through the Pennsylvania legislature last summer. But to speak to one of your examples, so Montgomery County, you know, they have a very forward-thinking, I think, Superintendent Joshua Starr, who has said, you know, called for a moratorium on high stakes standardized testing and doesn't use at least very much of that data in evaluating teachers. Montgomery County is also one of the richest counties in the United States. So they have a lot more resources to work with. The consortium, I would love to see more of that network happen in the school district of Philadelphia. I think it's imperative that we start getting ahead of the curve on that, because I think that's where, you know, rational people are going to be heading. That's what parents want for their kids. That's what teachers want. That's what students want to be doing with their time. And so I would love to see a pilot program put in place here in Philadelphia where we could exempt some schools from standardized tests and try a more performance-based assessment model.
Just can I respond for just 1 second? The Montgomery County model is a support model. I think that's the most important part of that. It's a system to provide support to teachers who are having some difficulty, and that's possibly the most advantageous part. Probably doesn't negate the idea of
I would agree that we shouldn't have to reinvent the wheel with that issue. I also think the district has often pursued and passed similar kinds of models, and the idea is they're not necessarily in fidelity of implementation because it costs money. And so the first thing that gets cut, or one of the first things that gets cut, are any
being measured by patient recovery. Oncologists were being graded on the same scale as the dermatologists for patient recovery, and an organization came up with a coalition for effective doctoring. I kind of pictured them being modeled on the Daily Show. That's how ridiculous I think this whole issue is, and irrelevant. Really irrelevant. We are facing an unbelievable crisis in the city. Mm-hmm. And of course we need effective teaching, but even before next September happens, we're already in crisis mode. I think there are just so many things that need to be done in order to have effective teaching, other than different kinds of evaluations.
One thing that this crisis really awfully has produced is almost 3,700, more than 3,700 layoffs, because there's no money to pay people. So now we don't have assistant principals, we don't have secretaries, but we don't make sure young kids are on the front door of the school, and teachers are gone, and teams are broken up, and teachers and children relationships are gone. There's money to bring them back. As it stands today, I'm a principal or a leader or a teacher leadership team, I can't bring the teacher back. I can't bring the teams to that. And I can't bring the team I want back because I don't have that freedom, because I'm not allowed to choose the staff in my building, because I have to bring folks back and shuffle them across the district based on how long they have been working in the school district in Philadelphia. And I don't think that's right, and I don't think it's fair for kids and teachers, and that's what this is really about.
So I'm speaking organizationally right now. I think that just that one critique is a little bit unfair. It feels a little bit personal, given that I think that PCCY has really taken the lead on a ton of this funding so far. And we're logging 70, 80 hours a week in the city and regionally and at the state level to make sure that teachers have what they need and the kids have what they need. And our frustration is that more folks aren't involved, right? So I think that there is a budget crisis, and that's why I have to go and sit with legislators who believe that Obama didn't grow up here and is not a citizen. But that's part of what will take on. That's part of the job. That's part of the territory of really getting folks to see why they should be investing in education. And that's why I can end up in places like Venezuela talking to people who don't want to talk to people that look like me. So I think that that's a fair critique to say teachers should have been brought in on the front end. I think that that has been heard, and I think some steps are being taken to remedy that. But I do think that what you have also, PCCY is pro public education. And our every deliberation, the charter folks are hating us right now about our barriers document. And, and the union is hating us now about this document. And I can't speak, I can't say my personal opinion, right, is a little bit different, and I even disagree with some things here. But I think that's opinion us all as, as hacking teachers and doing nothing beyond that does feel a little bit not honest.
I need to say
something. I think Lisa's point is the question of the professionalization of, or the deprofessionalization of the teachers, right? And so I think that's the heart of what we're feeling, and the fact that we're not being really treated as professionals, then you take additional resources away from it, just makes it even more disheartening. So I think that's the heart of it. Doctors have this professional perceived, but what can we do, and how can evaluation, or if evaluation isn't going to give us help our professionalism, then maybe it's a waste, because if we don't increase our professionalism, then again we really have no value. We just teachers,
I would say we agree really strongly. I mean, the notion at the end point is teaching is a profession. Every teacher is a unique individual with a unique set of skills and has to be honored as such. And if you have a high level professionals, tackle some of the hardest, most important work that we do in this country. So you can't treat teachers as human beings like widgets. And when you decide that a human being can replace another human being simply because of how long they've been working and these students love it, I feel like you're deprofessionalizing that. It's not fair, it's just not fair. someone that's been working 9 years is more important than someone that's been working 8 years. I've never been impressed. And I think that's part of why that deprofessionalizes to me. Let's honor teachers and the incredible work that they're doing human beings today.
Yeah, I can respond to Darren. I think I totally hear where you're coming from. I think on the face of things, it's really easy to say that site selection is a good policy and seniority is a bad policy. But if you are on the ground and you are a teacher, like the three of us are, you see some of the nuance and some of the problems. So what we see where we are is we see that there are a lot of schools that have no union protections. And what happens in those schools, in charter schools, what happens is that schools is very rarely see a teacher who's over 30 years old. Because the younger a teacher is, the less you can pay them. And so it's you can run your school more cheaply with young teachers and with less experienced teachers. Less experienced teachers also happen to be more compliant, and they kind of do what they're told. And that's not the case for more experienced teachers who have a lot more expertise. But are also higher up on the pay scale, get paid more because you know they have 10, 15, 20, 25 years of experience. So I think that there's a very real fear that without certain protections that have been fought for, you know, over the past 100 years, that we're gonna see the same thing happen in public schools, and that actually these financial crises are the perfect time to enact those kinds of reforms.
Done and have been done within the framework of a strong union environment. And I hear all this stuff, but I don't see any concrete evidence that site selection, that eliminating tenure and seniority have really led to improved educational outcomes. If you know some well-documented studies that indicate that, I'd be glad to read them. But I haven't seen them. I see a lot of talking points and a lot of rhetoric, but not real hard evidence.
Sure. Just point of fact about site selection. So currently in Philadelphia, every school building gets to decide whether they will be full site select or half site select. So this year, every odd position in a building that does not want to be full site select is still site select. So there is no building in the 263 this year, I guess 269 next year schools that can't pick at least some of their teachers in the site selection process. That's just a fact. My own experience, I've been a site selection committee member, I've selected teachers, I'm very happy to take on that responsibility. I've been on committees where that process is honored and worked. I've been on committees where that process is not honored and does not work. So until you actually sat on these committees and watched different principals do this the way it's supposed to be done, the way it's not supposed to be done, I don't think you really understand that when it says, hey, we're going to really want, some